AFC's finest fantasy football podcast. Here are your hosts, William Spencer, Jalen McQueen, and Mark Carter.
What's going on? Welcome back to another episode of the Fantasy's Finest podcast. I'm your host, William Spencer, and this is such a it's a great week. It's a great week to be excited about football because the NFL draft is just a few days away. There's buzz going on, all this information going on about NFL prospects, where they could be going, players' values going up, players' values going down. It's a signal that football is finally coming back. It's like the, I don't want to say prelude to the season, but it's kind of like that. Like, you get free agency in the beginning, you get the draft, which is like the really the true start to the season. The free agency period is cool, but it's not as a big of a draw compared to the NFL draft. All these young guys coming in, getting picked up by teams. They could be the new franchise players, et cetera, et cetera. And for fantasy, we get a new crop of players to talk about heading into the 2023 season, the 2023 draft season. If you're playing Dynasty, this is prime time fantasy gold right here, because especially in Dynasty formats, you have to know who to target when your rookie draft rolls around. And what better way to get into that than by listening to the podcast? So if you haven't subscribed to the podcast, let's run it down. We're on Google, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, iHeartRadio, so many more. Hit the subscribe button on your favorite podcast platform. You can follow us on social media, on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, and TikTok at Fantasy's Finest. You can follow me, the host, William. Hold up. All right, that's not breaking news. That's just my ringtone's going off. But let me get back, because, hey, man, you never know what's going on. Matter of fact, I'm going to get into something a little bit later in the news segment, because right before I was getting ready to come on and record, we had some breaking news. And I was like, oh, man, I wish I had jumped on right to record when this joint went off on my phone. But you can follow me on @hype_finest on Twitter. You can follow my co-host, Jalen, @_BlackMoscato. He's off this episode. He's handling some family business, taking care of the wifey and a new baby. And he's got another kid coming on. So congratulations, Jalen. I don't know if he wants me to say anything about if it's a boy or a girl or not, but he said it on social media. So if you're following him, go check it out. He posted it on his social media. He's excited, and I can't blame him one bit. But I had what I wanted to open up for the show this day, but I'm not sure whether I want to open up with it again, because we do have some breaking news, and I'm debating on whether I want to save it for the news and notes section segment. I think I will, because it's something that's we've been waiting for to happen. And it finally went down today. So I'm going to save it for the news. I'm not going to be long-winded. But what I wanted to open up the episode with today is I wanted to react to the Jalen Hurts contract. He became the highest paid quarterback in the NFL. He has a contract over 5 years, $255 million, $179 million guaranteed. It's a nice deal. And you know, whatever you want to feel about Jalen Hurts, you got to give him credit. And I know you're sitting there like, oh, my God, Will, are you what's wrong with you? Are you sick? Did somebody hijack your body? No, when you're a rival guy, I'm like, if you're new to the show, I'm a Cowboys fan, always been a Cowboys fan. So it's on site whenever it becomes Eagles versus Cowboys, anything Eagles. Yo, it's on site. I'm with the smoke. But you got to give credit where credit is due. Jalen Hurts played a very good season last year. Very good. So to say he hasn't earned the money, he kind of has. And granted, you know, you may be looking at him like, well, he ain't put the work in. He only played two seasons. He was drafted in 2020. And he sat behind Carson Wentz. Then when Carson got traded, he started playing and his first year was trash. Okay, that's fair. That's a fair assessment. But when you look at his deal, and then you look at when you would have to pay him, and considering the fact that if you waited, the price is only going to go up. Howie Roseman did the same thing that he did to Carson Wentz. He got out in front of the contract. He took care of his guy, made him one of the highest paid quarterbacks in the league. And he's out in front ahead of guys who are going to get paid coming up in Joe Burrow, Justin Herbert, Lamar Jackson, Dak Prescott, potentially, if he gets his extension from the Cowboys, which they've been talking about. All these other guys are going to get more money or somewhere above that 51 mark that Jalen Hurts set with his deal. So what better way to get out in front of it and get paid? And that's exactly what Howie Roseman did. You can hate the Eagles. If you're a Cowboys fan, you can hate the Eagles. I'm not going to say nothing about that. But you got to give credit where credit is due for Howie Roseman getting the deal done and getting it done quietly. Do you know what I would kill, who I would take out to get that from our front office? Because God forbid, every time it comes around to pay a Cowboys player, all the transactions, all the negotiation tactics, they're always in the public eye. Ezekiel Elliott, DeMarcus Lawrence, Dak Prescott. You don't think that that's going to happen when it comes time to pay CeeDee Lamb and it comes time to pay Micah Parsons? I would be flabbergasted if the contracts go down quietly and not a peep comes out of Stephen Jones' mouth or leaked information comes to the public. And it's all of a sudden, oh, you know, CeeDee Lamb's being greedy. Micah Parsons is holding out because he's not getting the contracts that he feels he deserves. I'm not trying to hear none of that noise. Howie Roseman did it the right way. He knew he had to pay his quarterback, and he went and did it in silence. And then according to reports, the Jalen Hurts's agent ended up breaking the news. That's how you're supposed to do it. Hurts earned the money. You were going to have to pay him. You got out in front of everybody else, man. And I honestly hope that Jalen Hurts continues to progress outside of when he plays the Cowboys and he, you know, I want him to suck, but Jalen Hurts earned the bread. There's no getting around that. He earned the bread. You can't shade him for that. He's one of the highest paid quarterbacks right now, and it's only going to be for a few more weeks until another contract comes out, and he's going to be pushed to the bottom. But the deal looks good. I don't know what else to say after that, man. He earned the bread. You can hate Jalen Hurts if you want to, but Jalen Hurts the person earned the money. He put the work in. You saw him progress as a passer. He's dangerous on the ground as a runner. He's accurate. He has a number one wide receiver that he can get the ball to. Devonta Smith is definitely a 1B. Now, he's not a wide receiver too. He's a 1B. They put weapons around him. He got the job done. Almost. You know, he ran into Patrick Mahomes. Patrick Mahomes is that dude. And the Eagles defense decided not to show up in the Super Bowl. But that's not a reflection on what Jalen Hurts did. So, yo, shout out to Jalen Hurts for getting the bag. Do your thing, except when you play the Cowboys twice a year. I'm just being honest. Now, the other thing I wanted to open up with is I'll ask you a question. I'll probably put it on a poll or a question on Spotify. But Jalen tweeted out a question on his Twitter account that I thought was very interesting. Who are your top five NFC and AFC teams heading into the 2023 season? And The reason why that's interesting is because many people, or at least when I made my comment on who I had in my top, who I had my in my top five for the NFC East, or not the NFC East, the NFC Conference, it kind of got some pushback. And I think that people hold too closely to the results of the 2022 season, and you're not looking at the changes that are being made in the offseason for 2023. Now, for the NFC, I had the Eagles at one because they've largely stayed the same. They lost a couple people on defense, but the guys that they've lost, they're replaceable. You know, they brought back their secondary. They still have some issues at safety. Their defensive line is intact. They're going to add more pieces in the draft. I wouldn't be surprised if they made a couple defensive player picks in the draft. But their offense has largely stayed the same. Their offensive line is still good. So they're number one. But here's where I got the pushback. I had Dallas as number two and then San Fran as number three. And that's when I started to get the side eye. And it's like, well, how could you do that? How can you put Dallas over San Fran? And it's not me being a homer, because I know some of you are out here listening and like, yo, all right, here come Will being a homer again. No, it's not that. Look at the teams top to bottom. And one of the glaring issues that the San Francisco 49ers have is the quarterback position. Brock Purdy is going to miss some time, if not the entire season, with that elbow injury. So you're already at a disadvantage from the start. And who do they have, you know, coming up? We don't know if Trey Lance is going to be around because they're supposed to be actively looking to get him moved via trade. They signed Sam Darnold this offseason. We already know what Sam Darnold is. You know, he went from the Jets to the Panthers, and now he's with San Fran, and he has done next to nothing his whole career. So I get that Kyle Shanahan is the kind of coach that he can somehow make them work inside his offense. But are you really counting on Sam Darnold to lead you out of the NFC West? Nah, I know I'm not. So despite everything that they have around him, it all comes down to whether or not Sam Darnold can get the job done. And he's never proven to be able to do that. Whereas the Dallas Cowboys, their defense is probably on par with the San Francisco 49ers. The offense is adding, especially this offseason and more than likely through the draft. I wouldn't be surprised if the Cowboys go and grab a wide receiver and a tight end, hopefully Darnell Washington. But they're making improvements. And you still have Dak Prescott at the wheel. And I know everybody's like, oh, well, San Francisco got his number. Okay, but you got to get to the playoffs. Nobody can have your number if you don't get to the postseason. And that's what the Cowboys have been able to do in back-to-back seasons for the first time in God knows how long. So that's why I got them up ahead of the San Francisco 49ers. And then, like, you got who? Who else would you put in at four? Detroit? No, but they are up and coming. Best believe they're going to be most people's dark horses coming into the season. Are you going to put the Giants at four? Nah, I'm not. I will go Seattle at four in the NFC. And then maybe Chicago or Detroit. I'll probably put Detroit at five, because I think that they can take that division with Jared Goff and Amon-Ra St. Brown. And we're going to get into some other stuff, but they have a very good team. David Montgomery is over there now. They still have DeAndre Swift, but they have enough to get to make some moves. And I wouldn't be surprised if they add a tight end too. So Detroit's on the come up. I would at least put them at five, with maybe the Chicago Bears making a strong case for six. And then in the AFC, you know, you got the Kansas City Chiefs, you got the Buffalo Bills. Miami would make a very good case to be in the top five. You got Cincinnati. Now, Kansas City, Cincinnati and Buffalo. Those are your top three. Then you have the Jets. See, I don't want to. We'll talk about the Jets later. But you have who else? Baltimore, if Lamar is healthy and he comes back and wants to play with the Ravens, the Chargers, they could be, you know, four, and Jacksonville. So Jacksonville may be on the come up too. They could be make your case for a six, but I would definitely consider Miami to be one of those top five. If Tua can stay healthy, that's what it boils down to with Miami. They got to fix that defense, but if Tua can stay healthy, he's going to be a big problem. I think people are still sleeping on him despite the fact that he was balling last year when he was on the field. All he has to do is turn it up now. But let's get into the episode, man. I done rambled on long enough. I just wanted to open up with some topics that I thought were a little bit interesting and wanted to weigh in on. But this episode, we got to get into some of my favorite prospects. I'm only going to give you a few heading into the 2023 NFL draft. My 2023 rookie watch. We got to get into that. So without further ado, we got some news to cover, baby. Let's get it. News and notes from around the NFL.
News and notes from around the NFL.
All right. So I've been holding on to this long enough. If you haven't heard already, or you've been living under a rock, I need you to get yourself up. Aaron Rodgers has been traded to the New York Jets. Adam Schefter reported the details of the trade. The Jets receive Aaron Rodgers, the 15th overall first round pick in the 2023 NFL draft, and a 2023 fifth round pick. The Packers receive the 13th overall pick, a 2023 second round pick, a 2023 sixth round pick, and a 2024 conditional second round pick that becomes a first round pick if Rodgers plays 65% of the snaps. Now, I'm going to ask you guys first, who do you think won the trade? Because I already know. In my opinion, the Packers completely got over on the Jets. Now, I'll be honest. It was kind of even all the way up until you get to that 2024 conditional second round pick. You swapped first round picks in this year's draft and you gave them a second round and you gave them a sixth round. I kind of feel like that should have been enough. As a matter of fact, I mean, the sixth round pick is not really moving any weight. So you gave them a first and a second. You switched spots in the first and second in the first round of the draft. And then you gave them a second rounder. That should have been enough. Because Rodgers, how long is Rodgers going to play? A couple more years, maybe three, if you kind of convince him to stay, if he feels comfortable enough. But you know how fickle Rodgers has been over the last few years. You can't count on that. So not only do you have to, you gave up an extra potential first if Rodgers plays 65% of the snaps, but you got to pay that tab too. It's almost $60 million on this year for the 2023 season for Rodgers. So not only do you foot the bill to pay Rodgers, you gave up basically two second rounders, but one can turn into a first rounder. What? That's a lot. That's a lot to me. The Jets. They got hosed a little bit on this one. I mean, they get Aaron Rodgers and it automatically bumps them up because, you know, I don't think you expect Aaron Rodgers to play the same way that he played last year. And like I said before, that was partly on him. He came in late to training camp and all that stuff. When you knew you had rookie wide receivers in Romeo Doubs and Christian Watson, you played the diva. You wanted all your old heads to run with you. Sammy Watkins and Randall Cobb and there was another wide receiver they had, or there was a bunch of bums. Basically, they were all bums, but you wanted to rock with them. You didn't want to give the rookies any time, and then you sucked, Mr. MVP. So hopefully Rodgers plays better. You got Garrett Wilson. You got Alan Lazard. That's the other name I forgot because he's on the Jets now. But you got Alan Lazard, familiar face. You got Garrett Wilson, who was bombed last year with garbage cook quarterback play for the Jets. And you get Miko Hardman. You got Breece Hall coming back. You got a lot of weapons. So for the Jets fans, expectations should be high. And Rodgers should be able to cash in. Rodgers should get his act together and be on the move. But I like the trade. I just kind of feel like the Jets got fleeced a little bit on this joint. Like that sucks. But hey, you got to get your guy. They went and paid for him. So that's that. Moving along, the Lions wide receiver Jameis Winston. I actually had a conversation about Winston earlier, but that's neither here nor there. Jameson Williams, the wide receiver for the Detroit Lions, and four other players were suspended for violating the NFL's gambling policy. Williams, as well as wide receiver Stanley Berryhill, Quintez Cephas, and safety CJ Moore, were all suspended for betting and violating the NFL's sports betting policy. And Cephas and Moore got released from the team. Williams and Berryhill are suspended for the next 6 games. They are not allowed to return until week 7. Did we not see what Calvin Ridley did last year? As a NFL player, why would you risk getting suspended over betting on the games? Now, Williams and Berryhill got caught a break, because they were betting, according to the reports, they were betting on college games, which is allowed by the NFL. But you did it at the Lions facility. Like, bro, you couldn't wait till you get home, got in a car? Really? You couldn't, like, go get something to eat, be at a restaurant, like, yo, dog, I'm gonna place this bet. Yo, this is going to be fire. Like, what's going through your head, man? We just saw Calvin really get banged for this. Why on earth would you put your career in jeopardy like that? Cephas and Moore are no longer with the team. They got cut for being morons. Respectfully. I mean, come on. You're making millions of dollars. And even if it's just a fun thing to do for you, come on, man. Know the rules. The other player that got suspended, I think he was with the Atlanta Falcons. But they all out. It's just stupid. You got to wait till week 7 to play in the NFL after having a bummy rookie season because of injury. Now, I say that to say Jameson Williams, I think he's going to be a problem. But now we got to wait another 6 weeks to see it. Of course, this is a bump for Amon-Ra St. Brown. So, you know, he's looking like an early to mid second round pick. You know what I'm saying? I mean, because who else are you throwing to? They probably going to have to pick up another wide receiver in the draft. But it's just like, come on, guys. We got to be smarter. You got money. There's no way in the world the bet that you were placing was going to be more money than you were going to make in a year. And like I said, it's probably a fun thing for you to do. I'm not knocking how you get down. But be smart about it, man. You got suspended for 6 games for betting on college games because you were betting at the Detroit Lions facility. You could not wait the extra 5 minutes after practice or whatever you was doing, film study, to just hop in your car, drive down the road, and place your bet. You could have did that through a McDonald's drive-thru. Come on, man. I need NFL players to move smarter. Y'all making millions of dollars. Come on, man. Don't mess up your career behind gambling. You know the NFL they ficky with that. It just burnt my brain. Like, come on, bro. You couldn't just wait a few minutes. Next up, Cowboys have exercised wide receivers CeeDee Lamb's 5th year option for the 2024 season. He's expected to make nearly $18 million in 2024, but the Cowboys do want to get Lamb on a long-term deal this offseason, and that would be smart. Finished 6th last year in receiving yards. You definitely want to get him locked in and have him on a longer-term deal, and that way you can get that whole cap situation situated and be in this one less person you got to worry about. Sticking with the Dallas Cowboys, the Dallas Morning News, Calvin Watkins writes that Cowboys coach Mike McCarthy has told Michael Gallup he will be featured more. Now, some may hear this news and be like, oh, man, come on. Michael Gallup's going to be featured more. You got to cut him some slack last year. He got hurt, tore his ACL the season before. He came back earlier than expected, tried to play through the injury. Then he ended up getting hurt. He ended up playing through other injuries. He had off-season surgery on his knee, his other knee, and his ankle. So he was banged up most if not all season, and he was trying to gut through it because outside of CeeDee Lamb, there was nobody else at the wide receiver position to catch passes from Dak Prescott and Cooper Rush. So I would cut him some slack. We've seen how Michael Gallup has played when he's healthy. He's fire, but we need that healthy Michael Gallup back. Moving along, we got Fox Sports. Ralph, I apologize for killing his name. Vaciano. Yeesh. Ralph Vaciano reports that the Giants don't have much interest in signing Saquon Barkley to a long-term deal. Barkley refused to sign his franchise tag, and he is looking to get a long-term deal with the Giants. He got hit with a non-exclusive franchise tag this offseason, so he can negotiate with other teams, but the Giants do have the ability to match those deals that come in. I kind of feel bad for Saquon Barkley because he played healthy throughout the majority of the season. He put up crazy numbers. He started off red hot. Best season in his career, probably by far. And he can't get paid off of it because the NFL owner's view of the running back position has changed. If you paid attention to the running backs that got paid this offseason, it just, the value has gone down. And these guys probably touch the ball more than any other position outside of maybe center and quarterback. So I would pay Saquon Barkley. I think he's earned it. I think the talent is there. And when you look at the Giants offense, yeah, they've brought in a lot of wide receivers, but they look like a bunch of two and three guys. Saquon Barkley is what makes the Giants offense go. Daniel Jones, and even in his best season of his career, quote unquote, and I wish you could see me do the air quotes. I wish you could see me do that. We need to get some video production up on this joint. But Saquon Barkley is the reason why the Giants are good. You remove that piece and you expect Daniel Jones to take over and be a elite passer. Not going to happen. You need Saquon Barkley, and the Giants do need to pay him. Speaking of running backs that aren't signing their franchise tag, the Raiders GM Dave Zell, I had this name pinned down, Zegler. Raiders GM Dave Zegler said that running back Josh Jacobs has not signed his franchise tag, and he will not participate in the team's voluntary offseason program. Jacobs, like Barkley, cannot participate in the voluntary workouts portion of the offseason for the Raiders, and he won't be able to do so until he signs his franchise tag or gets a long-term deal. Now, this I found a little bit interesting. Jacobs said that he was willing to play on the tag if the Raiders added more talent to the team. So far, they've only added Jacoby Myers, the wide receiver from the Patriots. I'm not mad at Josh Jacobs for not signing that tag either. You're just going to get the... It's frustrating because we all know what's going to happen to the running backs if they do sign those tags and play. They're going to get ran into the ground. So why wouldn't I want to cover myself with a long-term deal to get paid for what I'm doing? I get it. And it's just a shame because the scope of the running back market has changed. They don't want to pay running backs, even the talented guys. Shoot, the Tennessee Titans have been rumored to be trying to get rid of Derrick Henry all offseason. Oh, we got to talk about that too. I almost forgot about that. I'll finish this. I have one more piece, and then I'll talk about Derrick Henry. So according to ESPN's NFL insider Jeremy Fowler, Dalvin Cook, another running back, could get cut by the Vikings. The Vikings are trying to seek it. They've been trying to seek a trade for Dalvin Cook this offseason. Cook signed a 5-year, $60 million contract back in 2020, but the Vikings have brought back a cheaper option than Alexander Mattison on a smaller contract, and the Vikings could be looking to move on and stick with that cheaper option. Wow. That's three running backs right there. Dalvin Cook to me last season was okay. He was he finished around the running back 14 or 15 in fantasy last year. It's crazy how this running back situation is going for heading into this year. It's ridiculous. There's not much else I can say about that, but it's crazy. It's crazy out here for the running back position. Austin Eckler can't even get a new contract from his guy, from his team. He's only 27 years old. It's kind of messed up what the NFL is doing to the running back position. And speaking of running backs, I know y'all had to have heard the rumor or seen it. Akbar Gbajabiamila, former NFL Network analyst and current American Ninja Warrior host, he tweeted out that Derrick Henry was going to the Philadelphia Eagles. Now, I totally get that Howie Roseman probably was in there doing his due diligence if on a low. Let's just say he was on a low. It has been reported that no one has been talking to each other. The Titans haven't received any trade calls. The Philadelphia Eagles didn't inquire about Derrick Henry. But let's say Howie was being covert and he was just like, you know, hey guys, what would it cost to get Derrick Henry? I don't see the move happening, even though it's just a rumor. Because why would you let Miles Sanders go? Don't pay him. Let him hit free agency just to go and pay more money for another running back who's older. Derrick Henry is 30 years old. He'll be 30 years old, or he's around that age. That's not really a Howie move. And then Derrick Henry wants a new contract. After this season, he doesn't have any more guaranteed money on his deal. So he wants a new contract. You're going to have to pay him more, or you're going to rent him for 1 year and then let him walk so he can test the market. And then there were reports saying that the Tennessee Titans want a second round pick for Derrick Henry. Nobody's given a second round for Derrick Henry, respectfully, because he's older. And I don't think he's going to fall off either. That's just how teams are viewing the running backs in this free agency, in this offseason. It's crazy. But I'm like, Akbar, word? You really like? And the reason why, you know, people are believing is because him and Akbar and Derrick Henry share agencies. So he's like, you know, Akbar might know something. He used to be in the NFL. He used to be on NFL Network. And I get it. Those are good parallels to draw. But it's like, word, where did this come from? And now there are reports coming out that, you know, ain't nothing really going on. I'm of the, I don't believe it, or I'll believe it when I see it. But it's just funny to see, because it got Eagles fans kind of stirred up. And it's like, yo, Akbar, if this joint don't drop, they're going to be looking at you sideways. They're going to be tight with you. Yo, Akbar, you said Derrick Henry was coming. You said, remember where you heard it here. You heard it here first. If it don't drop, if I was a hardcore Eagles fan, I might be a little tight with Akbar too. But that'll wrap it up for the news. Thank you guys for listening to the news segment. Hopefully you got caught up. And now let's get into my 2023. Why did I say it like that? 2023 rookie watch. I got a few guys that you might want to be paying attention to that, you know, I'm only going to give you a handful of guys. A lot of guys, they've probably been talked about a little bit, but I got to give you my spin. I really like some of these guys. So let's check it out in the next segment.
Fantasy Rookie Watch.
Alrighty then. This is my 2023 rookie. It's about to sound like Emma Foot. Rookie Watch. These are a few names that I have on my list that I really, really like. I'm just going to give you a few because if I wanted to give you my entire list, it would be too long. And we don't have that kind of time. We got to stay within our podcast restraints for time. But look, let me first say that I think that people, NFL execs, are really sleeping on the wide receiver position heading into this draft. There are quite a few wide receivers that I think are starter level guys, and I think they're just being slept on. Like, some reporters have been saying that there's only one first round wide receiver to pick from. You know, the others aren't getting given a chance. Like, I don't understand it. But hey, if they feel like, or the people that know feel like that there's just only one wide receiver that you can pick in the first round, by all means, let them boys slide, because they should end up in some good spots if that's the case. Everybody, I don't know, I guess everybody's like, you know, we need offensive line and defensive players, and maybe that's the way that they want to go, but there's some good wide receivers out there, and there's some big wide receivers too. Like, I have a type, and I got laughed at for saying it this way, but I have a type when it comes to wide receivers. I like big, tall wide receivers that got speed on them. And the guys that made my list for this episode, they got the size, they got the speed, they got the hands, they have the route running, and they're not afraid of contact. That's what you want out of a wide receiver, at least to me. And there's a couple other guys that I couldn't put on my list just for the sake of time. But like, my first wide receiver on my list is Jaxon Smith-Njigba. And I know everybody's been talking about him, but there's a good reason why he's been making noise as one of the best wide receivers in this draft class, and why NFL executives and GMs consider him to be a first round talent. The first thing you notice when you watch if you watch film, if you watch highlights, whatever you watch to look at players, the first thing that jumps off the page to me is his route running. He is just crispy out there. He creates separation like it's easy. Easy. In his 2021 season, he racked up over 1,600 yards and 9 touchdowns. He averaged 16.2 yards per reception. That's crazy. And when you watch how he moves, you can put him at different spots. He's one of the wide receivers on my list that you can move around. He can play outside. He can play inside. He can play the slot. He can go over the middle. He can take those slants and take them the yard. He has the speed. He doesn't look, I'll say he's not game breaking speed, but if you miss, he's gone. I've seen a couple plays in his highlight reel, man. He takes a slant, makes a guy miss, and nobody's able to catch him. I see why people consider Jaxon Smith-Njigba a top wide receiver in this draft. I actually did an article for fantasydata.com. So you can go over there and check out my article at fantasydata.com. And I go into more detail on Jaxon Smith-Njigba and his fantasy value for Dynasty. I have him at the top of my list for Dynasty wide receivers. But go over there and check out the article. I won't give up a little bit any more time with this for, you know, Jaxon Smith-Njigba. But go check that article out, fantasydata.com, and let me know what you think, because he should probably be at the top of your list too. 6 foot, 196 pounds, 4.5 40 time. And that's another thing. If you're not running like a 4.4 or 4.3, they think you're slow. There are plenty of wide receivers at the NFL level that run 4.5s, and they still can't be caught. So it's like 4.5 is not horrible. I can't run a 4.5, but I'm like lineman size. So, you know, I mean, I'm not running 0.4s anyway. But 4.5 is not slow. And a couple other guys on my list run 4.5s. Don't play them for sweet because they're not, you know, Tyreek Hill-esque. But another wide receiver that I really like heading into the draft is Quentin Johnson. Now, he's been getting traction as of late behind Jackson Smith and Jigma. Wide receiver out of TCU, 6'4", 208 pounds. Let me say that right. Because if you like 280 pounds, you're like, bro, that's not a wide receiver. he's a tight end right tackle. 4.5, 2:40 time. Now, if you consider Jackson Smith and Jigma to be the wide receiver one coming out of this draft, if he's the 1A, I feel like Quentin Johnston should be the 1B. I like the fact that he's tall, he's got the size, he's got the speed. And another thing that I saw during his combine were reports that he kind of short arms passes, you know, he doesn't go up and get the ball. He kind of alligator arms. It kind of reminds you, they were making it sound like he was like Terrence Williams. Terrence Williams used to do that crap. He would go up and kind of body catch the ball. But when you looked at him during the combine, he didn't do that. And when you look at his film, I didn't see that, or at least not often enough to be like, oh, man, that's dangerous. He will go. He's got the size. He'll go up and get the ball if you put it up there. And he'll adjust if the balls are underthrown. He's not just going to give up on a play. He's going to try and make a play. And he's got great route running. I figure if I were to compare or say who was better between him and Jackson Smith and Jigba, I would probably give it to Jackson, but Quentin is not, I don't feel like Quentin is far behind in terms of route running. He's nice. He averaged 22.1 yards per reception at TCU during his rookie season. He didn't fall behind 16 yards per reception at the college level. You don't do that if you can't run routes or you just going on goes. Check him out. He is that dude. And I hope that all the execs that have been saying the things that they've been saying about this wide receiver class, please let him slide to 26. Give us a hard time to pick for the Dallas Cowboys. Put so many guys back there that it's just mind-boggling to select who we're going to get. Because if he slides to 26, oh my goodness, I would take him. If there's no offensive lineman for the Dallas Cowboys and maybe two tight ends, Kincaid is gone, maybe Mayer is gone in the first, I don't know. Give me Quentin. Give me Quentin. But I like Quentin. I think that he's going to be a nice dynasty asset for fantasy managers. And depending on his landing spot, which is, you kind of have to preface it with all rookies because we don't know where they're going to land at yet. But once we have the, we can do post-draft shows on recapping the NFL draft, we get to see where they land. We can then further evaluate their fantasy value. So I feel like Jackson and Quentin are probably the top two guys that you should be targeting in your dynasty drafts. If I had to guess, they're probably going in within the top six in picks. So that's just something to consider. Bijan Robinson. Let's talk about a running back real quick. He has been turning heads all offseason. And when I looked at his highlight reel, I kind of get why. 5'11", 215 pounds, 4'4", 640. He can do it all. 5.5 yards per attempt during his whole. Well, let me get this right because I wrote this. I made sure to put this down. 5.5 yards per attempt or better during his college career at Texas. And in 2022, over 1,500 yards rushing, 6.1 average, and then 18 touchdowns. And let's not forget that he can catch out of the backfield. He is a three down back. he's a problem. He's been tied to the Eagles. He's been tied to the Cowboys. He's been tied to everybody and your grandma. He's even been tied to the Falcons. And I actually just read a report not a while ago. It's like maybe a couple days. The Falcons are interested in Bijan Robinson to the point where they may take him inside the top 10. Now, I'm not going to sit here and say that nobody who has a running back shouldn't consider taking Bijan Robinson. But you went and drafted Tyler Allgeier last year, and he finished second among rookie running backs in rushing yards. Why would you go back and get another running back? That doesn't make sense. You need wide receiver help. You need offensive line help. You might need a new quarterback. We don't know. We don't know what Desmond Ridder is right now. But maybe it's a ploy to get somebody to jump up and trade that. Well, I believe they have the 8th overall pick. Maybe it's a ploy to do that. But it's just like, come on, Falcons. Don't be that guy. Don't be that team. Don't be that fantasy leaguer team who drafts a quarterback and causes a run in the beginning of the first round and causes a run. And we're not playing super flex. Like, that's actually happened to me. But no traumatic stories this time. But the Falcons don't necessarily need Bijan. Any team in the top 10 could use Bijan. I'm not saying that. But it just doesn't make sense to use that pick there when you don't necessarily need another running back, or you can get another one later on in the draft if that's your prerogative. But Tyler Allgeier has proven that he can be the guy. He can be a three down back. And if you stop giving carries to Cordell Patterson, you could let Tyler Allgeier be that guy. But that just bugged me. I'm like, why the Falcons? They don't need him. Now, I will say this. The Eagles, who pick at 10, they could use Bijan. And they would, adding Bijan to the Philadelphia Eagles would make the Eagles one of the most dangerous teams, if not the most dangerous team in the NFC. You have the fear of Jalen Hurts rushing out of the backfield already. And then you give him a true three down back who's more durable than Rashad Penny, who they signed in this offseason. They let Miles Sanders go, who had a career year behind that great offensive line. You put Bijan Robinson back there behind that offensive line with Jalen Hurts and everything that they got going on. You talk about dangerous defensive coordinators are going to have nightmares leading up to if they play the Eagles during the 2023 season. And they have a luxury pick at 10. They have two picks in the first round. You have the 10th overall pick. You can get whatever you want with that pick. It's something to consider if you're an Eagles fan. I know Eagles fans don't like it overall, picking a running back in the top 10, but if Bijan somehow slides to you, you got to consider it. I know Jalen was like on our last episode, Chicago should be in on Bijan Robinson at 9, I believe. Now that would be nasty. Similar situation. Justin Fields, new wide receiver in DJ Moore, Darnell Mooney, Chase Claypool for offseason. Bijan would be nasty with Chicago with what they do. Just because, you know, I would consider it. That's all. Now, let's talk about, I got another wide receiver for you guys. Cedric Tillman out of Tennessee. 6'3", 215 pounds, 4'5", 40. I told y'all guys, I got a type. I like tall, fast wide receivers. Tillman is just another guy that's in my category. Caught my attention. His best season was in 2021. He had over 1,000 yards, 1,081 yards receiving, averaged 16.9 yards that season. He's not afraid of contact. He looks a little bit slower than the other two guys I mentioned, but he still got some breakaway. He got some breakaway speed. Similar situation. If you miss on him, he will take off on you. You can catch him if you're fast enough or you're faster than him, but 9 times out of 10, he can go deep. He can make the big play. He's dangerous in the red zone. He has some shiftiness with him too. He's not just an up and down runner. Good route running. He can make defenders miss. Tillman is probably going to be one of those day two picks, second round, third round wide receiver picks. But I think he's a starter level guy, especially depending on the landing position. But Cedric Tillman, remember that name. Hopefully he lands somewhere where they got a quarterback that can get him the ball. Now, this guy right here is one of my favorite players to talk about this offseason. Darnell Washington, tight end out of Georgia. Dude is 6'7", 265 pounds, runs a 4.6. He should not be able to move that fast for his size. Now, I know one of the knocks against him would be, well, you know, he didn't do much. He didn't have a lot of production at the college level. And that's because you had Brock Bowers, the top tight end for Georgia, in front of him. But when you look at what he can do on the field, I was watching his highlight reel. Analysts were like, well, he's like a right tackle out there. He's not afraid to block. He puts paws on people out there. And when you got a tight end who can put hands on guys and move them, that makes your run game even better. But now, not only that, but he's 6'7". This dude got the nerve to be out there trying to jump over people, hurdle people. You should not be that big and be leaping over dudes. Yo, Darnell Washington is, I think that he's going to be a very good player in the NFL. I'm not saying he's going to be Travis Kelce or nothing like that. But if he gets with a team that actually utilizes the tight end position, he's going to be a problem. Darnell Washington is probably one of the few tight ends that I would actually give pause if he falls to 26 and I have to consider taking him. Because it's either him or Michael Mayer for me. I was kind of high on Dalton Kincaid, but I'm like, I looked at Darnell Washington and I looked at Michael Mayer and I'm like, I don't know. Those might be my top three guys, and Darnell Washington and Mayer are fighting for that number one spot for me. And Kincaid is number two, depending on number three, depending on who wins the battle. Because I can't pass on a guy who can block, get nasty with it, and then can go out and catch passes too, man. Like, he's huge. Pause. But, that's one of my favorite guys. I'm trying to get him on all my dynasty teams. I just hope he don't flop. But I want all the shares of Darnell Washington. All the shares. He's going to be, God forbid he lands with someone like the Jets with Aaron Rodgers now, Dak Prescott with the Cowboys. Like, those, give him a quarterback. Let him work. Let him be out there. Darnell Washington is going to be a problem, man. I can't wait to see where he gets drafted. I got to talk about another running back, Zach Charbonnet, out of Michigan, and then he transferred his last 2 years in college to UCLA. 6'1", 220 pounds, 4'5", 340. He was named first-team all-purpose specialist during his 2022 season with UCLA by the Football Writers Association of America. He rushed by far his best season, rushed for over 1,300 yards, 14 touchdowns, averaged 5 yards per attempt or better his entire college career, and he can catch 589 yards at the college level. My man gets busy. And I love bigger backs, 6'1", like I said, 6'1", 220. He can do it all. This is the kind of guy that you can get if you're looking at the draft. He may not be a first-round talent, but I think he's a day two, second-round or third-round guy. I would be shocked if he fell any further than that. He's one of those guys that should be taken probably in the second round, especially for a team that needs a running back. I think he's going to be a problem. I really like Zach Charbonnet. I can't really say much more about him. He's just one of those guys who's going to be on my list, and hopefully he gets a shot right out the gate, because I love nothing more than getting a running back or getting a running back that has an opportunity to actually start and produce in his rookie season. Like I said before, man, Breece Hall was that guy that I was trying to champion heading into the 2022 season with the Jets. And I didn't think that people kind of took to him like they should have, because they gave up a second round pick for Breece Hall. And then it came out, reports was coming out like, you know, oh, they're going to split work between him and Michael Carter. No, they're not. No, they're not. You do not spend a second round pick to get a guy to share the workload. At least to me, I don't see it. You don't spend, that's a third round or a fourth round running back, or you just don't have anybody else in that backfield. You're not splitting work with Michael Carter. We saw him, and he's not a bad running back. Don't get me wrong, but Breece Hall was that dude. He was an all-purpose back. That's why you went out and got him. And I feel like Zach Charbonnet can have that kind of impact depending on where he lands. Keep an eye on him. And finally, to wrap this baby up, Anthony Richardson, quarterback out of Florida, 6'4", 244 pounds, 4.43 40 speed. He didn't have a lot of production at the college level. Just 2,549 yards. It was his best season. He averaged 7.8 yards per attempt, 17-9 touchdown to interception ratio that season. Not a big body of work, but I feel like he has the physical tools. He's got the rushing ability. He's got the speed. He has the cannon for the arm. I feel like if he lands, and I personally want him to go get picked up by the Indianapolis Colts. I feel like the Colts with Shane Steichen, he could have a similar impact or growth like Jalen Hurts had. Now, I'm not saying he's going to be able to play at that kind of level. We don't know yet. But I feel like Shane Steichen has the blueprint to be able to utilize the skill set that Richardson has. And he's got some big targets over there in Indianapolis if he were to land there. You got Michael Pittman. You got Alec Pierce. You have a whole lot of tight ends that they refuse to use. You got Mo Alie-Cox, Jelani Woods, the other young boy, Kyle Granson. All them dudes are like 6'4 and up, 6'5 and up. He got some, and let's not forget Jonathan Taylor. You got weapons over there. And if Shane can use or have a similar style that he called in Philadelphia using all of those pieces, Anthony Richardson would be, I think that he would benefit the most from landing there. So he's one of my quarterbacks that I've really grown to like. Looking at his combine, looking at his production, looking over his production at the college level. Anthony Richardson, as far as dynasty goes, I kind of skipped it on a couple of these guys. But for him, I think Richardson can go in the first round in rookie drafts. I really do. He may go in the back. But he may get picked after Stroud and Young and Levi, but I think he's a first round talent that you're gonna get. You're probably gonna get him late at the back end if you're playing like a 12 team. He's probably in the back of the first round. I that's where he's going to get picked up at. Mid to late first round for the rookie draft. But those are my guys, man. Let me run the list down for you again. Bijan Robinson, Jaxon Smith-Njigba, Quentin Johnston, Cedric Tillman, Darnell Washington, Zach Charbonnet, and Anthony Richardson. That's all I'm going to give you all this time. I'm going to work on an article. We're actually working on an article now. I want to get out before the NFL draft of a few more guys that I think you should take a look at. But that's my list, my 2023 rookie watch. Those are the guys that have made my list for this episode. Got a couple more guys. But if you follow me on Twitter, you'll be able to see them too. So be on the lookout for the article. Be on the lookout for my tweets, hype_finest. That will wrap it up for this episode. Thank you guys for listening. Be sure to leave us a review on Apple Podcasts. Check us out there. Hit that subscribe button and check us out on our social media, all across your favorite social medias. Our TikTok is growing. We are almost at 6,000 followers on TikTok. We just crossed 240 on our YouTube channel. So check out those two spots, YouTube and TikTok. Help us continue to grow there. We appreciate all those who are listening, who follow us on those social medias. Twitter is almost at 1,300 for Fantasy's Finest, man. I love the growth. I love watching the growth. And I love engaging. So don't be afraid to leave a comment, like, share, do all that good stuff. Show us some love. And we appreciate every last one of you guys. Until the next episode, y'all take it easy. Peace.
Thanks for listening to the Fantasy's Finest podcast. Be sure to join the community on Facebook and follow us on Twitter too @TheFantasy'sFinest. See you next episode.